Aye.
My name is Megan Collier, and I have the honor of serving as Director of Symposia for MSC Wiley Lecture Series. The Wiley Lecture Series is a student-led committee within the Memorial Student Center that is dedicated to enhancing the educational experience through thought-provoking discussion on national and foreign policy. I would like to thank you all for joining us this evening for this discussion over artificial intelligence in the military. Tonight, our discussion will be moderated by Dr. Daniel Ragsdale, who has an illustrious career in both computer science and the military. So he was the optimal choice for our moderator for this discussion. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Ragsdale.
So this is really, I look at this as a wonderful opportunity. We've got you've got some wonderful panelists that come from a variety of perspectives and backgrounds. I had the good fortune, it's not in my bio, actually was a research analyst in the Office of Artificial Intelligence Analysis and Evaluation. So our short name was OAIAE. So we were frequently, you know, the EIEIO was another, and we were, people would yell out, buy a consonant. And it was during that time, as a relatively young officer, I began to get an understanding of how AI has significant military applications, and it was some very fruitful years. Learned quite a bit. Got to look at Army and broader military issues with respect to AI at that time. This is now early 90s. In the ensuing years, there's been an increasing number of issues where AI and practical applications for AI could come to bear. Certainly, the one thing in particular, we were speaking beforehand, the use of AI would be on systems that have lethal capabilities. So it's one of the issues certainly we're going to address very head on, I believe, in the panel. And with no further ado, I will like for Colonel Brown to describe a little bit of his background and the expertise he brings to bear, and then and the strategy is for them to have their opening remarks and then go on to the next speaker. So, Colonel Brown, please.
Hi, good evening. First off, thanks very much for inviting me and giving me the opportunity to speak to this forum. That's one of the great things about being at a university is that opportunity to exchange ideas and talk about important problems. I think everyone's got my bio. I think it was in the package, so you can kind of see what I've done in my career. These are topics that are very important to me because I have spent a number of years at sort of that forward edge of making decisions over life and death in combat zones. And so that gives you certain perspectives on how force is used, the moral implications and the ethics of doing so, because they're decisions that you have to make and then you have to live with, both the decisions you make and those that you don't make and the effects that it has on soldiers' lives and civilians' lives. I will tell you, a good friend of mine, a guy named Chris Glendo, when I was about to deploy to Afghanistan, told me something that always stayed with me. And he said that in Afghanistan, there are only two laws that apply. The law of gravity and the law of unintended consequences. So I've always, that stuck with me when I went, and I knew what he meant when I got back. So often, you know, we make decisions, we look at problems through one lens and don't consider what the unintended consequences of those decisions may be. And that includes in the policymaking arena when you're talking about the employment of different types of weapons. My last assignment before I came here, I was working in OSD policy, which is the civilian staff of the Secretary of Defense that's pretty broad reaching on policy things. And I worked in the Force Development Office there as well as in strategy plans and capabilities, and which case I had some opportunities to work on a number of projects, including studies that I was part of the team that authored a study on alternatives to the employment of anti-personnel landmines and cluster munitions, both of which fell under constraints of the Ottawa and Oslo treaties, respectively, where we were trying to deal with the fact if we wanted to come in compliance and we don't want to use anti-personnel landmines, then what would we do? And as we were discussing this, you know, the landmine is effectively the first autonomous weapon system. As simple as that may be, it's not intelligent, but it's certainly autonomous, that it operates with its on determination of when it detonates and who it detonates against. And obviously, it's operated by a victim. But at the very one end of the spectrum, that's the type of thing that we're talking about in terms of moral and ethical use of force. So having worked on these technologies, I've actually employed them in combat environments. You know, I've got some perspectives I'd like to share with you today. So are we going to do it? So go ahead and start off with my piece?
I think that'd be appropriate. You launch into your observations.
All right. So I just got a couple of things I want to touch on that I'll outline for you. First, I want to frame the concepts of autonomy and artificial intelligence from the military perspective, and then what's driving the military's innovation on these things. I'm going to hit where we're employing AI and where we're working on development of autonomy, and then touch on the ethical questions of autonomous systems employing lethal force. First, as I mentioned, you know, in autonomy, there's a spectrum that you're really talking about. From the simplest devices, such as landmines, through things like processor-aided systems. So a fly-by-wire system, stability control on your car, adds some degree of autonomous action to what you're doing. Then you have things like programmed autonomous operations, like an autopilot for an airplane, where it's very limited in what it does. It'll go from point A to point B without a lot of independent thinking. Then you've got full agency, and this is the idea of a device that's making independent judgments with flexibility over its tactical choices, its target selection, and engagement. DoD already has policy constraining autonomous weapon systems targeting humans. In 2012, then Deputy Secretary of Defense Ash Carter signed a directive that said that autonomous systems must be designed to allow commanders and operators to exercise appropriate levels of control over the use of force. Now, appropriate does a lot of work in that sentence. So that's something that I think we can kind of get at as we're talking through here. First off, there's a huge need for artificial intelligence in military applications for a variety of reasons. One, the speed of action that's going on right now outpaces human sensory and cognitive capabilities, especially in things like the cyber environment, where offensive and defensive actions are taking place at such a rapid pace and such a broad scope that individual humans lack the capacity to track and manage those systems effectively. Next, and I'm going to borrow this idea from some colleagues of mine, Michael Horowitz and Paul Sciari, who have done some work on this. The limits of programming make autonomous systems brittle when they encounter situations outside their intending operating environment. So you can tell a device, I want you to go from point A to point B, but when the longer point A to point B is separated in distance and time and space and other actors involved, the more difficult it is to accurately program that thing to tell it exactly what it's going to do and how it's going to respond, because you simply can't anticipate every contingency, particularly when someone is actively trying to undermine the performance of your device. And then the last is what I suggest, that the human in the loop systems, where a person is making a decision over when a weapon fires or doesn't fire, becomes increasingly unfeasible against adversaries that are capable of denying electromagnetic spectrum. So right now we operate in a world of UAVs that fly across the horizon, that are flown from Nevada, that operate through a system of satellite networks, where we can look down through a sensor and make a decision from thousands of miles away of whether or not we should launch a missile from that and fire that missile. But fighting against a capable adversary, Russia or a China or a state with those type capabilities, can easily interdict those GPS signals. They can use broad spectrum jamming to prevent you from communicating with that device, in which case it becomes useless. So if you want to have the capability to operate from long range, from standoff, you're going to rely on devices that have the capability to operate even when their communications and signals are disrupted by your adversaries. So those are the things that are kind of driving research right now. Real quickly, I'll hit a few of the things, areas that we're talking about. I'm not going to delve too long into cyber because we have other experts in that area. Certainly protecting the offensive defensive interplay in defense of our networks and attacking the opponent's networks is an area that AI is in use. Also exploiting big data to understand the enemy. And this is using artificial intelligence to grasp the enormous volumes of data that are available in open sources to understand and visualize where the enemy is. Some of that work's actually going on right now at Texas A&M through the multimedia monitoring system that that is working on. Where this is, think of every Russian soldier that's operating in Ukraine has internet access right now and is taking pictures and sending them to his girlfriend and is texting his friends and is taking videos, and all those are geotagged. So cell phones are going around, they're geotagged, and a really smart system can look at a phone, look at the type of communications that are coming from that phone, make a determination, that's a soldier. Can look at the picture and see his uniform and maybe listen to his accent, make a determination of where he's from, aggregate the 40 or 50 soldiers that are all sending those communications and messages, figure out where they are, and then track their movements all the way across Ukraine by aggregating that individual bit of soldier data. And artificial intelligence is a way that you can get a handle on all that enormous amount of data that's available in open sources and use it for intelligence. Logistics, you know, there's a lot of thought that we can use artificial intelligence to manage our supply chains better, use automated delivery, perhaps, to reduce the manpower requirements of sustaining forces that are deployed. We already have significant autonomous systems already in the field for defensive purposes, that our ships have what they call phalanx systems, which are use a combination of radar and kinetic guns to identify incoming missiles and shoot them down. Those systems operate autonomously. They're put on autopilot, and if they detect an incoming threat, they'll interdict that. Those things are pretty widespread. There's about 40 nations that are using them. We use them for our air and missile defenses, for our counter battery against artillery fire. All those things are already in place right now. The key in all these types of things is that artificial intelligence is really needed to detect and react to threats faster than human operators can. They have to be able to make decisions about relative threats. If you have multiple missiles that are incoming, making a determination which are the ones that are likely to hit, which is the greatest threat, and which one should I engage first. That's something that a human doesn't have the capacity to deal with in that type of environment. And last is reconnaissance. And that's designing vehicles that are going to be able to operate in that environment, where I'm not going to be able to pilot it remotely, but I would really like to send an underwater vehicle into, you know, the Straits of Taiwan, let's just say, and find out what the Chinese Navy's doing. But it's about a three-week trip underwater to do that. And I have limited capability to communicate with that UAV, or that UUV, underwater vehicle. So developing AI and placing it in platforms that have the capability to operate by themselves without control over long periods of time is something that we're looking at. All right, so just real quick talk about ethics. What we're struggling with right now is, when does the employment of AI start to run into challenges ethically when those elements are actually using lethal force to target other people? And that's something that I think that this panel could have a pretty good look at discussing. That military ethics and war fighting are almost always situational. And it's a combination of discrimination, making determinations of what are lethal targets, what are appropriate targets, what aren't. What targets are necessary to hit because of military necessity? How important is this? Is it worth the risk? Is it worth the cost to actually strike it? Proportionality is the amount of force that I'm using against this target justified by the military necessity that it has. And then accountability, in that who is making that decision of what's hit? Who makes that decision of when you pull the trigger and what's destroyed? You can delegate that, but you can't eliminate the responsibility for it when you're a commander. What I would tell you, though, is there's no ethical requirement to have a fair fight in a combat zone.
I think I'd be remiss not to say that one of the things that Janowitz did during his career, he's dead now, one of the things that Janowitz did was establish an interdisciplinary international professional association for the study of civil-military relations. It has a name, but it's long and ugly and best left unsaid. But the association is vigorous. We have a great number of members. We meet every other year in one city or another. And we discuss many of the matters that we'll be discussing tonight. Like the one that Colonel Brown mentioned, like a lob of a little hand grenade or something into the audience. We have to fight, maybe, but we don't have to fight fair. I'm pretty sure about that principle. But not every society agrees. There are culturally, there's some cultural variation there that we'll want to talk about and see if it bears our attention or maybe doesn't. Well, in any case, I don't want to spend all my time talking about what we're going to talk about. I'd rather talk about what I plan to talk about. That has to do with the moral implications of using drones. And you'll see that I have a very narrow definition of drones. I'm in a slippery area when we talk about artificial intelligence systems. There are experts here that can talk to you about that. I'm going to focus strictly on the matter of morality. And as it affects the use of drones understood as unmanned aerial weapon systems. Okay, so what drones can accomplish, and at what benefit, and at what costs, remains an open question. It's open question because it's a changing field, but it's an open question also because all the data aren't collected, all the data that we would need to make some definitive statement. Those data aren't available. What has been collected hasn't been publicly shared or widely shared. As a result, opinions about the use of drones are unsettled. They're matters for dispute. I can't cover that whole field of study, but I can limit our focus in this way. I'm going to ask three basic questions. I'd say ask and answer, but that would be arrogant and promising more than I can deliver. The first question that seems really obvious to me is to ask, what are drones? What are they? Are they good or bad weapons of war? That's our first question. Second question, we ask, what do drones do that makes their use morally controversial? What is it about drones? What is it about what they do, what we do with them, that makes them a source of moral controversy? Third question, and the last. What are the moral implications of using drone attacks in lethal combat? What are the moral implications of using drone attacks in lethal combat? Okay, question one. Are drones good or bad? By drone, I'm referring, as I said, to an unmanned aerial weapon system used for killing or wounding one's enemies from afar, with little or no risk of being killed or wounded in return. I'll say that again. An unmanned aerial weapon system used for killing or wounding one's enemies from afar, with little or no risk of being killed or wounded in return. This definition takes in the popular image of drone pilots sitting in the comfort of their offices on a military base, directing drones to hit targets located over a continent away, and then returning to their families in a nearby suburban neighborhood to enjoy a lemonade or a game of catch with one's children. Notice that this image is strange. It is vaguely troubling. It is anxiety provoking with a scent of the immoral about it. the picture of soldiers equally bearing the hardships of trench warfare in World War I, that picture is nowhere to be found among the drone pilots. Nevertheless, historically, there are examples of weapons that generally fit this description of the drone pilots engaging in war from a safe distance. The examples tell of choices to prefer fighting with swords over, excuse me, these examples tell of choices to prefer fighting with spears over swords, to prefer fighting with machine guns over rifles, or to prefer carpet bombing by night over bombing by daylight. These choices seem to plot a rational course to follow. Take the way that's safest for you to win the war. But there are also cases in which the rule of fighting at a safe distance was honored in the breach. More important than choosing the obvious path to winning war was the good of fighting well. Choice has to be made. Consider the Crow in North America fighting against their enemy, the Sioux. It was the Crow's custom to engage their enemy face to face. The Crow warrior planted his coup stick in the Sioux warrior's ground and then killed him. The Crow warrior's act of dominance would be the last thing that the Sioux warrior ever saw. Honor to the Crow was earned by killing his enemy in this intimate way. Sneaking up on his from the back, sticking him in the back, that wouldn't do it. That wasn't what the Crow thought was important about warfare. Counting coup was the path to social honor. Nothing else would do. This warrior culture lasted until the Crow were forced to live on a reservation and prohibited, and was prohibited then from counting coup anymore. We have another example, probably well known to you, the case of the Japanese samurai. Faced in the 16th century from a war culture based on guns to a war culture based on the sword, the samurai gave up the gun. They banned guns from their island, and that allowed the samurai to rule for three centuries more until the Americans invited themselves to stay for a while. The choices states make are often stark. Adopt the drone-like weapon and gain an advantage on the battlefield, but upset the traditional norms defining what is meant to fight well. It's a dilemma. The choice often puts the goal of winning over the norms of fighting well. As a result, drone-like weapons may acquire a reputation for being ethically questionable. All depends on how one calculates the relative importance of fighting well versus winning. But we should not overstate or oversimplify the matter. We shouldn't try to resolve the dilemma right away. All depends on how one calculates the relative importance of fighting well or winning. And that may change from situation to situation and time to time. A drone is not simply a good or a bad weapon. A drone is simply another weapon in the toolkit. What matters then is not what the drone is in itself. Is a drone good or bad, as if it might be such a thing. What matters is how and why the weapon is deployed, and what are the moral implications of its deployment. That's question one. Kind of a messy answer, but I stick by it. Second question. Why and how do drone attacks stir moral controversy? Drone attacks are morally controversial in part because drones are technically so proficient at what they do. They are able to identify and kill enemy targets
from far away with high degrees of accuracy using a technology that is relatively easy to use at a relatively low cost. The moral problem is that drone attacks may be too easy to use. Drone pilots may not take seriously enough the task they're assigned in a battlefield of a kind. Drone pilots may not take seriously enough the task they're assigned if only because mounting a drone attack may too closely resemble playing a video game. Drones, so easy to use, critics say, tempt abuse. The temptation is all the greater because there is relatively little regulation of or agreement about how drone attacks should be done. In practice, the problem is how to establish a regulatory regime over the use of drones which is consistent with the rules of law and with the traditional conventions of just war theory. The problem is hard to resolve. May the president order a drone attack to kill an American citizen who is under surveillance in Arabia, who is suspected of engaging in terrorist activity? May the president do that? Faced with this problem, President Obama authorized the killing of the suspected terrorist who was a citizen. But was he legally or morally right to have done so? Are not United States citizens entitled to the due process of law, especially from the president, even when traveling abroad? Some are trying to create a legal and moral framework that might help us decide when and how a drone attack may be authorized. A typical example of such a framework would say a drone attack was morally justified when killing in self-defense was necessary, when a drone attack was the only means to end the threat, when it was possible to distinguish civilians from combatants, and the attack would limit any damage done to bystanders. Others have been less restrictive in their thoughts about a moral framework for the justification of drones. They forward only two principles to authorize a drone attack. One is that the attack be launched against combatants, not civilians. The other is that any damage done by the attack must be proportional to the military advantage gained by the attack. Still others have questioned the idea that combatants on all sides of the conflict are not morally equal. Equal treatment is not due soldiers who are not fighting for a just cause, they say. And that's certainly what we can say about terrorist combatants, what they are doing. In this case, restrictions on the use of drone attacks may be loosened further still. In these examples, there is a keen appreciation for what drones can accomplish to identify one's enemy, to keep track of the target's movements over time, and eventually to kill the target if doing so seems to be in the nation's best interests. These technical feats can be carried out with greater accuracy and at lower costs than can be done by many other weapon systems. This success arouses suspicion about what drone attacks may do. The weapon is new. It lacks an articulate legal and moral framework to justify and regulate its use. Agreement about how to regulate what drones can do is urgent, but incomplete. It's not a matter solely about how states control the weapons under their control. The drone technology is easily purchased off the shelf and modified for use as a weapon. The regulation of what drones do poses problems beyond national borders. Well, that's enough of that slippery slope. Let's turn to question three. moral implications of the use of drones. What are the moral effects of relying on drones as weapons in our arsenal? There are two matters in particular that I want to consider. Many more that we might, but two for today. One is to ask about the possibility that the use of drones will lead soldiers and others to treat war less seriously than they would otherwise do. I include this complaint because it's so often cited in popular media. The fear was that a drone would have no more moral weight than a video game would do. One does not want to conclude this, but one does not want to conclude this matter prematurely. It should be noted that this fear so far is unwarranted. That the available data tell us 29% of drone pilots experience burnout owing to the tension of their deployment. 17% were clinically distressed. Some experienced systems of PTSD as a result of their service. These are not the statistics of people, of airmen, of drone pilots who failed to take their work seriously. On the contrary, what the data do suggest and what some reported was the absence of medical attention to care for the drone pilots who needed it after deployment. Lastly, though on the same theme, there's been inadequate communication about the number and the consequence of drone attacks already launched. It was not until 2012 that the Obama administration officially acknowledged its use of drones. It was 4 years later, and under political pressure, that the administration released a summary report of the number of combatant and non-combatant deaths owing to attacks. This is in the time period 2009 to 2015, and dealt with terrorist actions conducted outside of areas of active hostilities. The report did not tell the number of combatant deaths owing to the use of drones or other forms of air power. In any case, the number of deaths reported were low, only 116 non-combatant deaths in 2015, only 2,581 combatant deaths. These numbers may seem high or low to you. I can tell you they are very far below the estimates prepared by NGOs and other private parties. The numbers were not only far below those available for the private sector, they were not reported in a way that permitted deeper analysis. This is unfortunate. Current channels of communication about drones are unlikely to create the bonds of trust needed to trace the moral and implications of using drones around the world. So long as using drones stirs moral controversy, the legitimacy of this use of force will be called into question. No effective system will be built to oversee the use of drones. We will be left in confusion and moral doubt, which is a hard place for liberal democracies to be.
Okay, thank you for your remarks. Our third panelist is actually a colleague of mine from the Department of Computer Science and Engineering here at Texas A&M. Dr. Yoonsuck Choe has focused on topics in computer science and the overlap between that and neuroinformatics, and as such has bring some great insight to the topic.
Right. Great. So I prepared a brief presentation. So let me just go ahead with it. Thank you. Okay, so I hope you can hear me without the microphone. Considered to be pretty loud. Anyway, so I'll talk about AI in the military from the perspective.
Would you like to use this one here?
Oh, okay, yeah, that's fine. Either way, it's fine. Okay, so from a perspective of, from AI. So again, I'd like to thank Megan and Wiley Lecture Series organizers for this kind of invitation. I really enjoyed listening to the other panelists talk about these different perspectives on the use of AI in the military. So I guess everyone's interested in AI in general, but not many of you really dug into the history of AI, so I'll just give you a brief history of AI. And it's interestingly kind of intertwined with the military. Alan Turing is a famous computer scientist, so basically he's the founder of computer science and also artificial intelligence. And guess what he did during the World War II? He did the code-breaking stuff. And a lot of the other AI-like technology that was considered during that time period was machine translation. So that's the main reason why the military got interested in the use of development and use of AI. In the 1950s, AI was born. The very term artificial intelligence was coined in 1956 at the Dartmouth workshop on AI. So initially, people thought about what's really the essence of intelligence in the human mind, whatever the human mind operates. Of course, we saw that humans think logically, right? So we think that animals are not very logical, they're not rational, okay, unlike humans, right? Of course, we all know that humans are at times not very rational. Anyway, so people thought that logic, if you simulate logic, then it'll bring us this intelligence revolution. Okay, that was during the 60s and 70s, and again, the military put in hundreds of millions of dollars to this endeavor. Okay, but of course, logic is fundamentally limited. This is always a yes or no, or black or white. But as anyone here, or anyone in the military might say, there are lots of these gray areas, and logic-based systems cannot deal with these. And also these AI systems, they only were able to do what humans told them to do. They cannot do anything beyond the call of duty. Okay, so that hence came the first AI winter. They call it the AI winter, not the nuclear winter. So that's when the DARPA, at the time it was actually ARPA, the Advanced Research Project Agency, they cut funding, so people got poor in AI. And they abandoned the field of AI and some other ideas. And then in the 1980s, believe it or not, neural networks suddenly came into the scene. Right now, neural networks are really hot. You see news about deep neural networks every day, almost. So I'm teaching a course on neural networks, on AI and machine learning and so on. But I get tired posting all of these news on my course webpage because there are so many of these. So anyway, so now the neural networks came to the scene in the 1980s. And a more advanced form of logic-based AI came about, which is called expert systems. So these were used by corporations, military, to make wise decisions and so on. But anyway, they didn't deliver. So the second AI winter came. And there was a huge, so billion-dollar industry working on these expert system type of technology at that time, and that whole industry collapsed. So again, people got disillusioned by AI. Why? Because we set our expectation too high, right? And I guess foremost, we really don't know what intelligence is. We don't have a good definition of it. Anyway, so people abandoned some of these early approaches. And then with the advent of more advanced computing hardware and lots of data, people started shifting to machine learning. They don't want to now hand code intelligence into their algorithms. They wanted these algorithms to learn from the data that we provide. Right, so that's when machine learning and probabilistic models made a huge advance during the 90s and 2000s. Again, as you know, now we're living in the 2010s, and deep learning, I guess everyone heard about deep learning, which is a form of neural network which learns from the data without humans having to explicitly say what they should do and what they should not do. So now you see the pattern. There was the first AI winter after huge hype. And then there's another hype, and then there's the second AI winter. And now we have a huge, extremely enormous hype, which is deep learning. So the question, the billion dollar question is, will there be a third AI winter? Right? So people are kind of cautious at this point, but they're kind of optimistic this time, because deep learning has shown superhuman performance in many tasks. Right? So now instead of thinking about facing this third AI winter, they are now thinking that there will be a fourth industrial revolution. So anyway, so as you can see, there are several milestones that somehow astounded humans. Okay, like in 1997, IBM's Deep Blue system beat the chess grandmaster Garry Kasparov. Okay, that was a huge success, initial success, but that didn't lead to much. Have you heard of IBM's Deep Blue commercializing their chess machine? Actually, what they did was they used their parallel architecture to build on top of that to actually build a powerful parallel computing hardware. Now they put this in name like Deep Blue, Deep Blue, there's the deep whatever, they have the nomenclature called deep something. And then, of course, DARPA again, always a very, very supportive entity about AI-related research, because of obvious reasons, they sponsored this million-dollar DARPA Grand Challenge for autonomous vehicle driving in the desert environment. And then the team from Stanford won, and a lot of that team actually went to Google, and they started building the Google autonomous vehicle. And in 2007, DARPA again sponsored the Urban Challenge, because who cares about driving in the desert, right? You want your car to drive in a city environment. And for this, the CMU team won. And in 2011, IBM built their Watson system to basically beat these human contestants, former champions from the game show Jeopardy. Okay, and I think this next one is the most important recent advance. So how many of you have seen Google DeepMind? It's a company based in the UK. They built a neural network to play the Atari 2600 games. So how many of you have played the Atari 2600 games? Well, I'm kind of surprised. So when I showed, yeah, of course. I myself played some games at my cousin's house. Anyway, so when I showed them my class, my machine learning class, the photo of the Atari 2600, and you may have seen it, and the reaction was gasp. Such a primitive device. But anyway, so what's really amazing about this Google DeepMind's result is that they just used an emulator, software emulator, to emulate the games inside the regular PC. And then they take the video sequence, so they take a time window, and they take several frames, and then just feed that into the neural network. And then just based on this video sequence, they're not doing any feature extraction or anything, they're just feeding raw video signal data into this neural network, and then trained it to play the game. So the output is to basically move the joystick. So these joysticks are really primitive, it's not even analog. You just have a switch on these eight different directions. So if you move it up, then it'll contact that switch, and then it'll move you upload and download and so on. And then there's one, just a single red button. So there are these different combinations of moves and button press or nothing. So that's the action that was mapped from the basic video signal. And they were able to use the same system to beat many of these games beyond make the system play these video games way beyond human average. But some of these games they can play, I don't know, 100 times better than humans. It's kind of amazing. So and then immediately 1 year after that, they came up with this ancient game of Go, playing machine called AlphaGo. And then it shocked, I guess, for most all of the Koreans. I'm a Korean, by the way. Anyway, the Korean government, industry, all of these people got totally shocked by this. And so they put in hundreds of millions of dollars to just start this AI research institute type of thing. And I heard that they have no idea how to spend the money. But anyway, that was a huge, huge blow. And of course, they beat the former world champion pro player, again, a Korean guy, Lee Sedol. But anyway, to the credit of humans, he actually won at least one game out of five. And of course, AI technology is pervasive nowadays in some sense, like Siri, Amazon Echo, driverless cars, and so on. But again, there's this shady ground between between automation and autonomy. I'll talk a little bit about that. So many of these things, let's say, like what the drones do, or let's say if you make a drone autonomous, make a decision, track video, and then shoot something, some target, and so on. In some sense, it's all basically automation, the same as driverless cars and so on. So is it truly autonomous, or is it just a more advanced form of automation? Because we have to think about that and make that distinction. So I'll show you some demos. So I'll first show you the Google DeepMind's Atari video game playing thing. So turn off the light. I guess you'll be able to see it. Let me just see if you can see it. So you know, this is the breakout, the game of breakout. So it's a little bit hard to see the ball. Can you see anything?
Yeah.
Okay. So it's a little bit hard to see from here. So now, if you play this game, you'll note that the best strategy is that actually dig a tunnel on one of the sides, and then now the game will play itself. You don't need to spend too much effort. So this is exactly when it happened. And all of this, without telling it anything about the game, you just basically read off the score. The numerical score, and then that became a reinforcement signal. So it's kind of amazing, and this is just the beginning. So there are lots of more advanced games that it can play very well. Okay, obviously I scooped this from the Wired website. Okay, let me show you the next one, which is. So now this is based on, based on the neural network.
Welcome back, Zeppelin here. You're watching a skilled player play Super Mario World, but this player is not human. It's a computer program I wrote called Mario. This program started out knowing absolutely nothing about Super Mario World or Super Nintendo's. In fact, it didn't even know that pressing right on the controller would make the player go towards the end of the level. It learned all of these things through a process called neuroevolution. In this video, I want to teach you about how Mario learned to beat this level, Donut Plains 1, what his brain looks like, and how it's all based on actual biological evolution.
Yay.
So let's start off how Mario is able to press by its feet, but modern technology isn't there yet.
Here's how it looks like.
On the left side, you have the inputs. This is what Mario sees. It's a simplified view of the level. The white squares stand for blocks the player can stand on, and the black squares stand for moving objects like enemies or mushrooms. On the right side, you have the outputs. These are the 8 buttons that Mar.io is able to press by using its neural network. In between the inputs and the outputs, all those lines and boxes, those are the neural network. Each free-floating box is called a neuron, and the lines connecting those boxes are like the axons and dendrites in a human brain. At any given time, only some of these neurons and connections are actually being used, and this is what people talk about when they say you only use 10% of your brain. The neural network you're seeing is a pretty complicated one, and it got so complicated as a result of a 24-hour evolutionary learning session. So, to explain how neural networks work, let's rewind about 24 hours and look at how the whole process started.
Okay, so I'll just
this is what Mar.io looked like at the beginning of its training session, all the way back in generation number 0. The program is probably even dumber than you thought at this point.
It's not
often it just stands there and doesn't even press any buttons. If Mar.io stands still for too long, it'll cut off the simulation and try the next neural network. So it's mostly just jumping from one simulation to the next. But occasionally, the neural network says to press the right button, and the player starts walking right. Behavior isn't complicated, but it's enough to make at least some progress in the level. Let's take a look at a sample neural network to understand just how that works.
So anyway, so we can take a look at this. But I mean, this is really pretty advanced, right? You don't need to tell it anything about the game, and it will learn from the experience. So I guess this is kind of the things that AI can do right now. Learning from data, learning from the environment, at least in this case, a simulated environment. Just going back to my talk. So I was given 3 questions. What is the level of autonomy AI can achieve? The second is what are the potential threats of different AI capabilities? And the third is what are the fields that are to benefit from AI? So I'll talk about these 3. So again, these are just my personal opinion, and people in the AI research field might disagree. I would guess that anyone does not agree with anyone else in AI. So some things that are desirable and achievable soon would be, I have to be very clear that I'm not saying that AI will replace dogs, or AI will replace dolphins, or secretaries, or accountants, and so on. I'm just saying that they're as a human or as an animal, right? So I'm saying that what they do in their task, their specific task, can be doable by AI in the near future, like dogs in their military, police, and civilian duties, okay, or dolphins in their duties in the Navy, and secretarial work, reserving a room, making flight travel arrangements, and so on, accountants doing the accounting stuff, drivers, pharmacists, teacher, right? Kind of surprising. And by inference, maybe professors, too. Lawyers, analysts, etc. I hope that you don't have any of these in the audience. There's some professors here. Well, actually, good news for professors. Desirable but unachievable in the near future, researcher. Right? Professors that have multiple duties. One is to teach, one is to do research, one is to provide service to the community. Anyway, so research is a very highly creative endeavor. Okay? And the results are not subject to human, human emotion or something. So I didn't put in art or creative activities like music, composition. Right? Because, again, I don't want to berate artists or musicians. Yeah, but the thing is that now the value of art when you create it is very subjective. The value of music is, again, very subjective. Whereas the value of research based on science is objective. I hope so. So research is a valuable creative activity that I don't think AI can achieve in the near future. And the same for programmers. I'm kind of biased because I'm a programmer, I'm a scientist. Programming is a very, in many ways, a very creative task. And it's very difficult to, I mean, if I can write an AI to write a program, then what should I do? I'll just retire. Just like this guy in Silicon Valley, who realized that, okay, I'm earning $150K a year. So if I ship off $50K to some other country, okay, and have that guy develop code for me, right, then what can I do? I can just use my $100K and do no work. And this guy is giving me high quality code, right? So, well, I'm living a good life. And this actually happened, by the way. And of course, he was caught, unfortunately, for him. Okay, and there are certain things that are unknown, to me, at least. So true autonomy, as in humans and animals. So true autonomy here means that when we do something, when we perceive something, when we hear something, when we see some information, read some information, we know the meaning of it. And the meaning is intrinsic to me. So how many of you think that a desk calculator understands arithmetic? How many of you think that a desk calculator can perform better than human on arithmetic tasks? Many.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, but the thing is that now, let's say I press 1 plus 1 equals, then it displays 2. But what is the meaning of 2? When I tell you suddenly, out of the blue, 2 is the number 2. Yeah, then what kind of things come to mind? Yeah, there are 2 people, there could be 2 computers, there could be 2 candies that I can eat. Okay, if there's 1 candy and another candy, then we put together, then it becomes 2 candies. all sorts of things come to mind. Okay, but this desk calculator doesn't have that meaning. So number 2 display, the meaning of the number 2 is not in the desk calculator itself, but in the human's brain which looks at that display. Right, so meaning is not intrinsic to the system. And by inference, meaning is not intrinsic to computer or any artificial object. Unless there is some, unless that artificial being somehow implements some of these fundamental principles that give humans meaning. And also AI is really good at solving problems, nowadays especially. So if you can formulate the problem in AI problem, or any problem in AI terms, then you can solve it. You can just run it through Google's TensorFlow neural network system, or something like that. If you provide data, if you provide the necessary representations. Okay, but one thing AI cannot do really well, or almost not at all, is posing these problems. They cannot come up with what problems to solve. Right? So that's the main problem with AI. How much time do I have?
Just a couple more minutes.
Yeah, okay, great. So what are the societal impacts? So it can be either very positive or very, very negative. And I guess that depends on the policymakers. That's why you should vote very wisely. And potential threats of AI capabilities. So I guess the general worry is that AI is doing some stuff that doesn't understand how and why things are done. You know, and also how AI doing stuff that humans don't understand, or how or why. Okay? And dealing with ethical dilemmas. Okay, but of course the humans are not very good at dealing with ethical dilemmas. Okay, but, so there's some specific stuff like robots maybe okay. But I guess the cyber, once you enter into the cyber sphere, then it becomes very problematic. Because its reach is pervasive. Right? It can cause a real hazard to humans, like meddling with the power grid or the financial system, cyber infrastructure, and so on, or political system, and so on. And I guess really the real danger is not not directly related to AI capabilities in itself, but in the possibility of worsening societal inequality. Right? AI, so people who has AI technology, people who does not have AI technology, there'll be a wider gap, a widening gap. And things like job loss are real issues. So there are many fields that can benefit from AI, especially when repetitive work is required. But can't you just do that by automation? Okay, so now, because of that, we need the second part. Okay, repetitive work requiring frequent adjustment to the different circumstances. So that was raised earlier by the other panelists. And working in unsafe environments, augmenting human capability, not replacing it. I guess this would be a key aspect. Right? So again, the keeping the human in the loop idea, aiding the aging population, and the disabled, and there are many military applications possible, yes. Infiltration, surveillance, sabotage, big data monitoring, espionage, counter-espionage, and also prosthetics for those who are wounded. Yeah, of course, don't give them the nuclear launch button. There are many issues like meaning is not intrinsic, I told you about that, autonomy versus automation. And one last thing I want to talk about was the asymmetry in the decision. And so we are worried about AI going out and killing someone, yeah, making decisions on its own. Yeah, but there are two types of decisions that I can, in terms of, two kinds of decisions in terms of military usage. Decide to harm when not explicitly told so, okay? Or decide not to harm when explicitly told to do so. Right? So the first one is a little bit more problematic. The second one may be a little bit okay, right? Because if no one was harmed, maybe that's okay. So that's all I have.
Well, thank you. Yeah. So what we're going to do now, I actually have about 57 questions that I want to pose to this group, but I believe that the real value of this is not just hearing these experts, and frankly, I have to, you know, to give them a great deal of credit. They have really plumbed the depths and also provide a great deal of breadth to how we would look at these topics. So I'm going to take my prerogative to only ask one question. And then we'll open it up to questions from the group. And in our long discussion at dinner and even here, I have been intrigued by this notion that on the one hand we're looking at, is it ethical ever to engage autonomy or have autonomous systems that can bring lethal force? That's the one that comes to mind. That's the one we have addressed very directly. But there's a flip side of that. Should we not pursue, and this is the question that I'd like each of them to address, should we not pursue infusion of AI technologies into systems that would actually cause them to be more discriminatory, to ensure that the response is proportional, to ensure that the engagement is a military necessity, and frankly, just to increase, in some respects, the accountability. So it's actually the flip side. Should we embrace AI as a means to conduct warfare in a way that adheres to the law of warfare, the many international treaties and norms that have been established over time, as a way to conduct warfare in a way that is more ethical, that reduces the likelihood of civilian casualties and reduces so-called collateral effects and so on. So why don't we start on the end, please?
So I guess that is a really good question, but I guess there's an underlying assumption that all parties that are involved, your enemy states, they are also thinking about ethical use of AI, right? So if that is the case, I guess that's all good and well. Whereas, if your enemy is not interested in any ethical use of AI, and they want to basically bend the rules or break the rules, then that becomes an issue. Then the question is, should we continue to be ethical while, of course, this is a very sensitive topic, right? But in general, I think ethical use of AI in military could be possible, but you first need to understand the capability of the AI, okay? And because that should be the main prerequisite, I guess. Okay. Because depending on what kind of capability you're talking about, it may or may not be okay.
Okay. Yeah. My response is very close to what we've just heard. The question you ask is whether AI can be helpful in intensification of AI systems, could be helpful in constructing the legal and moral framework that we would like our troops and maybe everybody to follow. The problem is that collective construction is an original act by humans.
Yeah, so that was actually, I wasn't asking should we use AI to develop new norms and develop the ethical framework. I'm just saying, should we infuse AI technologies into systems such that would make them less likely to violate the law of warfare as it currently exists, as it currently has been codified?
Where has it been?
Well, unfortunately, I'm very sorry, we're out of time. We only had the room until 8, so if you have any questions, I would feel free to come up to the speakers after the program. We're going to have to leave the room. Thank you so much for coming out tonight. I would like to thank our speakers for all the information that they provided us, and I'd like to remind you that we have our main program coming up on April 5th, so keep an eye out for that. Thank you.